What are the five things you should know about media when you're starting a new ministry? If you're a student or you're a young pastor or you're just engaging in ministry, what are the five things you should know about media that will help propel your ministry to a new level? Stay tuned. The world has changed. I'm Phil Cooke, and I spend my life working with pastors, ministry leaders, nonprofit leaders, helping them understand how the digital revolution has changed the equation for ministry. We have a team in California, in Los Angeles, called Cooke Media Group, and I've spent almost four decades working with pastors and ministry leaders from around the world, helping them share the message of the gospel to a culture that's probably changing more dramatically than in any time in history. And certainly the digital revolution is a big part of that. So if you're a student, if you're a young pastor, if you're a young ministry leader or a leader in the Christian community, I just want to take a few minutes and share about how to connect with your community, how to reach out to people, how to expand your opportunities for sharing the message with some of the tools that are out there. Now, in this session, we don't have time to talk about how to use social media necessarily or how to build a website, but I do want to give you some background that'll help you understand why it matters and what are some of the steps you need to take to really engage it in a professional way and in a way that will help you most of all in ministry, because I think that's so incredibly important. Now, let me give you a little background that I think will set the stage for what we want to talk about today. And that's, if you've heard me speak before, you've heard me talk about the fact that researchers, I think it was in Britain, who recently have said that the average person today sees about 5,000 media messages every single day. Now, that's literally being bombarded. My dad was a pastor in North Carolina in the 1950s and 60s and never had to deal with that. Certainly, we had three channels of television. We had a few radio stations in Charlotte, in the town I grew up in. But today, we're literally being bombarded, and that includes print ads, it includes television, the ads you see on a computer, or the ads you see in social media. We're literally being overwhelmed with ads, and as you know from some research, that the more opportunities you have, the more choices you can make, the more people tend to shut down. There was a famous study recently of ice cream, and when you offered three choices of ice cream, people bought a whole lot more than when you offered 20 or 30 choices of ice cream. Choice tends to overwhelm people. So we live in a world where people are coming to you already completely overwhelmed. In fact, some of it has to do with our cell phone. I've seen some studies that indicate the average person today checks their cell phone about 150 to 175 times a day. Now, the horrifying thing is that middle schoolers are checking theirs up to 85 times a day. So it's affecting people of all ages, and it's a huge, huge problem when it comes to distraction, when it comes to disruption, and how certainly it disrupts our work life. And, you know, a tribesman in the heart of Africa today with a cell phone, and trust me, they all have them because I filmed them, has access to more information today than the president of the United States did just 20 years ago. So you start to see just how radically things have shifted. In fact, when you read 7 days of a daily newspaper, you've read more information than a person just 100 years ago read during their entire lifetime. Now just think about the comparison for a minute. 7 days of a daily newspaper today is more information than most people read in their entire lifetime. And that's grandparents, great-grandparents. That's just 100 years ago. So the shift has been radical. And as human beings, we've not done a brilliant job in trying to keep it up. So what we have discovered as a ministry leader that you need to know is that it's changing our behavior. Neurologists have always felt like, aside from learning, our brain was fairly locked in. It was, you know, the same brain we have throughout our entire lifetimes, but we're discovering today it's a lot more plastic. There's a lot more plasticity involved in our brain. And this digital culture we live in, where we're experiencing so many distractions every single day, is actually changing our behavior. One study recently indicated that when you meet someone for the first time, you decide what you think of that person in the first 4 to 8 seconds. I mean, think about it. You've got 5,000 media messages bearing down on you. You have unlimited choice. You have this incredible opportunity to do different things. So when you meet somebody, you start making the decision right away. Think about it. You haven't had time to meet them. You haven't had time really to get to know what they have to say or develop any kind of relationship. But because we have so many choices, we're being pulled in so many directions, we simply have decided to make choices about things that we don't even know about yet. Think about this in terms of church. We now live in an 8-second world, which means, I tell pastors all the time, I'm glad your sermon's anointed. I'm glad your worship is fantastic. But in an 8-second world, what's the parking experience like getting to your church? In an 8-second world, what's the lobby look like? In an 8-second world, who's the first person a new visitor meets when they walk in the door? Because trust me, they're making decisions starting in the parking lot. And we worked with one church recently in Texas that had identified seven different places they could engage with a new visitor between the parking lot and the pew. Between them getting out of the car and them sitting down in the sanctuary, seven places they'd identified where they could engage with an incoming visitor. So when you think about ministry in terms of the 8-second world and you filter everything you do through that, and that's not to say we want to be shallow. That's not to say we don't preach significant theology. That doesn't mean we don't go deep in the Word of God when we do preach and teach. But it does mean to capture their attention is the single most important thing you can possibly do. Because in many ways, attention has become the currency of this culture. Because if we can't capture their attention, I don't care how great a teacher you are, how great a preacher you are, I don't care what God's called you to do, I don't care what your intentions are, or how wonderful they may be, if we can't capture their attention, we have failed. So we have to think in terms of the 8-second world. We all live in that 8-second world. So suddenly, front burner things become how we engage with them right off the bat. What's the first thing we do for them? And we don't want to overwhelm them. We worked with a church recently that their communication director was literally overwhelming the congregation with information. She would do 3 or 4 email blasts every week. She would send out a summation of everything that happened at the end of that. Every 2 weeks, she'd send out an envelope with a mailer in it with updates. Every month, she'd send out a little catalog of everything the church was going on. People were being overwhelmed with information. She was sending out email blasts and text blasts, all kind of stuff. And we did focus groups of the church. And everybody, without exception, said, oh, no, I just delete those. I just throw them in the trash. People get overwhelmed if you over-communicate. So we have to be very selective in an 8-second world about what the message is, how we're going to engage people, and how we're going to connect. So I want to talk about really 5 things that I think today are going to really help you as you launch ministry. Some of these things you know about, but I'm going to talk a little bit about how we do them as ministry leaders and ministry professionals. 5 things that I believe will help you as you engage in your church, as you engage in ministry, in your local community. Number one is social media. Get on it. You know, some people, even today, and now your chances are you're a young ministry leader, you get social media, you understand it, but here's some things I want to tell you about it. Number one, social media can be a powerful way to brand you and your message. You want to be a ministry leader? Great. I talked to a guy the other day that wanted to be an evangelist, and he wanted to launch a new ministry. And I went on his social media pages, and he had pictures of kittens. And I said, you know what? Pictures of kittens doesn't say anything about your dream of being, you know, taking the Word of God to the nations of the earth. We have to think in terms of expressing visually and through the content we share on social media who we are and what we want to be. So certainly social media can be fun. I mean, if you go on my, I'm at Phil Cooke, Cooke with an E, P-H-I-L-C-O-O-K-E. And I'd encourage you to check out what I do on Twitter versus Facebook versus Instagram. Instagram is like a playground. I just have fun with that. And you can do that. That's okay. But you're in your bio on social media, in your photos, and the stuff that you share, and the things that you choose to talk about. You should really focus on your dream and your calling and what you want to do in your life. I have a friend, Dan Rockwell. He's on Twitter as Leadership Freak, at Leadership Freak. He's brilliant, brilliant leadership advice. And here's the funny thing. That's all he talks about. He doesn't talk about sports. He doesn't talk on Twitter or Instagram or Facebook. He doesn't talk about politics. He doesn't talk about recipes, anything else. He talks about leadership. And people know when they go to his sites, they're going to get leadership advice. And so the more you brand yourself, even as a ministry leader, chances are God's called you to a certain type of ministry, perhaps in a certain place. And maybe along with that, there's something you're insanely passionate about. Jack Hayford is a great example I always use for young leaders. Jack Hayford, I went to his church for 20 some years, and I've heard Jack preach millions and millions of messages. But if you cut Jack, he will bleed worship. I mean, he's written 5 books on worship. He's written more than 100 worship songs. He led the worship. He didn't just preach at our church. He led the worship, which means everything Jack does in ministry, he does it through the lens of worship. My question for you is, what's that lens that you could view your life through? And if you figure that out, whatever it is, that thing you're called to, it's not a job. It's more of a calling, a passion, a purpose, a destiny, if you will. Whatever that is, you get on board with that and then express that through your social media, you'll see people really start to follow you. Follow people you admire. You know, take it seriously. Don't just follow everybody. I follow far fewer people than follow me because I really want to hear from a select group of voices. And trust me, I want to say this to you as you're in ministry. The voices you follow are the voices that are going to manifest themselves in your life. I mean, I really have to take a hard look at Twitter and Instagram and Facebook at the people I follow, because do I want those voices speaking into my life every single day, multiple times a day? I have to really filter those voices. I don't take just anybody. I want to be careful that I'm not getting too immersed in politics or too immersed in sports or too immersed in one subject over another. I want a real balance. And so I'm constantly thinking about who I'm following on social media, and it can have huge impact because that's going to start being reflected in your ministry and your preaching and the things that you do. So, but here's the thing, follow people you do admire, and then occasionally respond to them. When they say something profound, respond to them. Now, chances are they've got tons and tons of followers and they won't respond every time to you, but occasionally they may. I've had it happen to me a number of times where somebody with more than a million followers said something really profound. I responded to him, and guess what? He responded to me. That means that particularly on Twitter, when he responds back, all of his million followers saw my Twitter handle. And guess what? I take a bump in followers. People probably assume, hey, if this guy responded to Phil, maybe Phil's pretty smart. Maybe I should follow him. So think about that. It's a great way to grow. And just be strategic about your social media. There's a lot of stuff out there on it. In my book, Unique, Telling Your Story in the Age of Brands and Social Media, I talk about it. But trust me, every book you read is going to be a little outdated because things are changing on a regular basis. But social media can be an exceptionally powerful tool for launching your ministry if you use it strategically and really focus and think about what you share. The second thing is, I want to talk about websites. Second thing is your church website, and here's the principle. It's not for your church members. Your church website is not for your church members. Think about it for a minute. Your church members know where you're located. They know what time the services are. They know who the pastor is. They know all that stuff. Your church website should be designed for new visitors, potential visitors. That's who's checking in. I can tell you, after working with churches and ministry since long before the internet came about, I can tell you today, virtually 100% of new visitors will check you out online before they come. Which means if that's the biggest reason or one of the biggest factors they use to decide whether or not to visit your church, or donate to your ministry, or whatever you want them to do, if that's one of the biggest reasons, your website should be one of the best things you do. Trust me, we build websites and design websites for churches all over the country, and we've just discovered that if you design it for a new visitor, get them the information they need, make it easy for them to access, 1-2 clicks at most, make it easy, make it visually interesting, because that image that they see on your website, that's what they're going to walk away thinking about your church. Is it easy to access? Is it diverse? Is there a lot of excitement there? How's the worship? How's the preaching? All those kind of things. New visitors want to know about this stuff. So stop thinking that your website, when you go into ministry or if you're in ministry now, stop thinking your website's for church members and start thinking it's for new visitors, which may even be non-believers. So think about how you can attract those people through your website. And if you could design it with those people in mind, you'll hit a home run. Okay, the third thing is your church has a brand. Now, let me just say quickly about branding. This is not an opportunity to talk about brand. I can't go into whole depth and detail about branding, but let me give you a couple thoughts about the concept of branding. You've no doubt heard about it. I wrote a book years ago called Branding Faith. Why some churches succeed and others don't. And I updated that into my new book, Unique, Telling Your Story in the Age of Brands and Social Media, because as I said, we need to be updating these things. But I kind of started the branding conversation in churches. And it's because a brand is simply a perception. It's a perception. The reason Nike puts so much effort into their brand is because they really want to change your perception about Nike or Starbucks, FedEx, major companies like that. And when you think of Hillsong, people recognize their brand immediately. Or when you think of Elevation in Charlotte or Lakewood in Houston or Prestonwood in Dallas or maybe Life Church in Oklahoma City, some of the great churches in America, people have a perception about those that are largely driven by the brand. A brand is simply a story that surrounds a person or an object or a thing, a product. Everybody has a brand. You have a brand. I have a brand. Oprah has a brand. Tom Cruise has a brand. Everything has a brand because it's a perception people have. Now, in many cases, a brand can also be the promise you're making to people. That brand, that story is also caught up in the promises you're making to your customers, your congregation, your community, whatever it is. The point is, in a digital age where people are being extraordinarily distracted, they need an easy hook, an easy way to categorize your church or your ministry. So think in terms of a brand being that. And that's why you need to think seriously about what is the perception my church has? What is the perception that people think? Well, a great way to put it is, what do people think of when they think of you? What do people think of when they think of your church? And trust me, it matters. In a world where they're being bombarded with other choices, in a world where it's so competitive. I mean, when I was a kid growing up in the South in the 50s and 60s, we didn't have a whole lot to do on Sunday. Church was a big deal. Big deal. Today, not so much. Today, there's tons of things. Sports opportunities, movie opportunities, shopping opportunities. In the old days, they kept stores closed till after church. Not so much now, certainly in the major cities. Here in Los Angeles, man, church is hardly a blip on the radar. So in a world of those choices, how do we make your identity more visible? And one piece of advice I'd give you is understand from the top, you can't reach everybody. This is a really important thing for young pastors and ministry leaders to understand. You cannot reach everybody. Remember in the New Testament, Jesus went to towns where he couldn't reach everybody. Even Jesus got frustrated and left towns. He told the disciples, if they don't listen to you, just shake the dust off your feet and move on. Move on. That's the thing to understand. You can't reach everybody. So what do? We focus on the people that are most likely to engage with our ministry, as it's called, the low-hanging fruit. There are tons of people out there. Trust me, if every church thought of, okay, what are the unique gifts in our church? What is our unique location? What is my unique vision as a pastor? If we start thinking of all those things, what makes our church unique? What makes us stand out? What makes us different from everybody else? Trust me, if every church in America did that and started reaching the group that they're most likely to engage with, we could reach the world. We could reach everybody. But because so many of us are trying to reach everybody, we're not reaching hardly anybody at all. So when you go into ministry, think about creating that identity, that brand identity around who you are. What's God called you to do? What are the gifts that you have as a leader and as a pastor, as a ministry leader? What are the gifts of your team? Remember, Hillsong got on the radar because of their music. They had an incredibly powerful music ministry. And every church has something different. Craig Rochelle at Life Church, the leadership guy. There's so many. Joel Osteen at Lakewood Church is about hope. Jack Graham at Prestonwood in Dallas has built this amazing, amazing church based on leadership principles. He's a brilliant leader of leaders. So whatever it is that God's called you to do, think about that as part of your brand identity and go after the people that would most likely respond to that. I hope that makes sense because it's absolutely important and it'll save you an enormous amount of grief. I know too many pastors that stay awake at night worried about the people that they're never going to reach anyway. Let's start focusing on the people. Trust me, you could grow to a huge church just with that low-hanging fruit of people that are likely to want to hear your message. Couple last things. Number four, a key thing when you're launching ministry, particularly as a pastor, I go back to Jack Hayford because he's such a good example. Years ago, when Jack Hayford started Church on the Way, his church here in Los Angeles, in Van Nuys, California, here in greater LA, he did something absolutely brilliant. Now, this was 40, 50 years ago, but he did something that was brilliant. He called up the local religion reporter at the Los Angeles Times newspaper. Called him up and said, hey, I'd love to take you to lunch. Let me take you to lunch. So they went to lunch and he said, look, I just want you to know, I know that you as a religion reporter cover everything. You've got to cover every religious issue that comes down, all the issues in politics that deal with religion, every kind of religion there is. I just want you to know that I would be happy to put my staff at your disposal if you ever need research, if you ever need us to make some calls or look up things, whatever we can do for you, I just want to put my staff at your disposal. Guess what? For the next 40 or 50 years in the LA Times, whenever they needed to do an interview with a religious leader about something, guess who they picked? Jack Hayford. Jack Hayford got millions and millions and millions of dollars of free advertising in the Los Angeles Times over all these decades simply because he reached out an olive branch to the local religion reporter, became his friend, offered to help, and guess what? They developed a relationship. So no matter what comes up, maybe it's a scandal within the church. Maybe it's some issue in the Catholic Church or in some other religion. they call Jack. They want Jack's comment. So here's the thing. Now, in many communities that you may go into or you may be in, they may not have a great religion reporter. Or they may not even have a religion reporter at all. It may be a small news outlet, but there's somebody there that deals with it. Maybe local radio, maybe local TV, maybe even if it's a local tiny little newspaper. My suggestion is go seek out that person. Find out who's the person that gets tasked with doing the stories on religion. Become their friend. Take them to lunch. Offer to help if you need to. Whatever you could do to establish that relationship. I just know too many pastors in America that constantly complain that they always get negative publicity in the local media. And it's largely because they've never taken the time or made the effort to reach out to local media professionals and extend an olive branch. You know what? The media is not, I live and work in Hollywood, and I don't believe Hollywood is anti-Christian. I just think Hollywood, the most of the leaders in Hollywood have never grown up in the church. They don't know anything about it. They're more ignorant of all things Christian than anything else. So what the best thing we can do is, instead of criticizing Hollywood, let's reach out to them. Let's reach out to them. Let's try to turn Hollywood, let's look at Hollywood as a mission field instead of the enemy. I mean, think about it. Think about it. What do we do? Missionaries go to a third world country. They find a tribe. They become friends with them. They develop a relationship over time. They get to know them. They work side by side with them. They love them. You know, but if we treated them like we treat Hollywood, we go to a third world country, surround a tribe, hold up protest signs, criticize them, tell them we're not going to do anything with those guys. It's a strategy change. We've got to think of Hollywood as a mission field, and if we could do that, it would make a big difference. But when it comes to your local media, even if you're starting out in a church of 20 people, reach out to people who are really telling the religion story in your local community and become friends and develop those relationships. The last thing I'd say is number 5 is learn how to lead creative people. I'm going to tell you something. In a digital age, in a media-driven culture like we live in today, a successful pastor, a successful ministry, needs to understand how to lead creative people. Here's a few tips for leading creative people. Number 1, you need to inspire them. You know what? A lot of employees, you can lead by being real hardcore on them. You can lead them by being serious. And obviously, you want to be serious with creative people. But I'll tell you, you want to give creative people some latitude. You want to give them some rope. You want to give them some space because you want them to surprise you. If you're not creative yourself, and trust me, before we get too far into this, let me just say, everybody's creative. There's no research at all, just in case you're one of these people that think, you know, God called me to ministry because I'm certainly not a creative person. We are all born wildly creative. Put a bunch of toddlers in a room. Show me one of them that's not creative. Give me a break. We're all born creative. But it is interesting that somewhere around age 6, kind of coincidentally, when we start school, we start losing that creativity. So I think, first of all, rethink yourself as a creative person. We all are, and we need to be trying to do creative things. But when it comes to leading creative people, one of the first things you realize is give them some space. But another thing is give them deadlines. You know, it's funny. Creative people will complain, because I'm a creative person. I'm talking about myself here. We'll complain, but the truth is I don't even start a project till I see the end of the runway in the distance. You know, when I see that deadline looming, I love that quote a writer said about, I love deadlines. I love the whooshing sound they make as they fly by. When I see the deadline getting scary close, that's when I really start getting serious about the project. So don't be afraid to give creative people deadlines. That's an important thing. And I would also just say, work to develop a creative culture in your entire organization, in your church or your ministry. You know, like I say, everybody's creative. So your youth people could be more creative. Your senior adults could be more creative. Your parking lot team could be more creative. Whatever you have, whatever access you have, or the resources and people you do have on your team, look at them as creative people. Never discount their creativity, because you'll be amazed at what people can come up with. So I think these 5 things are really, really important. Number 1, social media. Start taking it seriously. There's a lot of resources out there for learning how to use it more effectively. Start thinking of your calling. Every time you post, think of, how is this contributing to my calling? How is it shaping people's perception about who I am and the message that I'm sharing? Number 2, understand your church website is not for your church. It's for your visitors. It's for potential visitors. So make it something that would make them amazing, make them just die to come to church. Make it so compelling they want to come and visit. And number 3, understand that your Your church has a brand identity. Work to make it more visible. Figuring out, get with your team, figuring out, okay, what is the unique identity of our church? Why do people come? What makes us attractive to people? Why do people get interested in the ministry of this church and my ministry as a pastor or ministry leader? Figure that out, because that is what, that's your key to growth, really your key to growth. Number four, make contact with local media. Don't become isolated. Don't become hostile to local media. Certainly, they may not be Christian. They may not be sensitive to anything Christian. I get that. But let me tell you, it doesn't help to do battle with the media. It's not going to help your position in the community. It's better to reach out in some way and figure out common ground. And if you can get them on your side, it's just absolutely amazing. And then the last thing, number five, is learn to lead creative people. Make this a passion in your life. You know, leadership matters. But I'll tell you, in ministry especially, leading creative people can have such amazing results. Chances are, if they're pastors or ministry leaders or churches that you admire and love in this country, chances are they are good at leading creative people, and that's what's helped build them. I mean, think of it. Craig Groeschel at Life Church in Oklahoma City, his team created the YouVersion Bible app. I mean, they've had more than 1 billion downloads of that. Now it came out of a church because Craig recognized the creative level and talent of his people, let them run. And it was just amazing what happened. So learn to lead creative people. I think these are such important things. What you're doing, what you're being tasked to do as a pastor or ministry leader is unbelievably remarkable. And it's enormously important. I mean, get your theology straight. Get your doctrine straight. There's nothing worse than somebody going out on a binge out there and doing something strange that way. But understand that if you can communicate that message to a bigger audience, it's really powerful. It's just incredibly powerful. I mean, you can, I know, I met a pastor the other day, give you a good example, that pastors to 700 people in his congregation, but he has 10,000 watching him every week on their live stream. Think about that just for a minute. He's a global ministry. Half of those people are international. He preaches to 700 in the pew, but has 10,000 people watching him on his live stream. He's learned how to leverage media to share his message with a much greater audience. We have churches that we work with that literally are making as much as a third of their total income from their live stream audience. The world has changed. When live stream began, most pastors were afraid to do it because they were convinced nobody would come to the church. And by the way, I've seen no evidence anywhere that that's been the case. People engage in live stream for a lot of reasons. My wife and I, when we travel all over the world on a regular basis, and wherever we are, if we're there on a Sunday, she'll pop open her laptop and we'll find our local church's live stream and we'll watch the local church from wherever we are in the world. If you know people, particularly in this episode, who are launching in ministry, who are still in college maybe, or just starting a church or starting a ministry or a nonprofit, share this episode with them. I think this could really help them understand some of the critical things for launching out there and getting out there and just putting their ministry on the map. And as always, go check out my blog at philcooke.com, philcooke. I'm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, at Phil Cooke. And I'd love to talk to you there. I'd love to engage with you. And if you have any questions, send them to info@cookmediagroup.com, COOKE, cookmediagroup.com, info@cookmediagroup.com. Ask us some questions, because I'd love to address them on future podcasts. I'd love to start taking questions and really just talking about some of the things that you wrestle with, some of the things that you're struggling with. It's very, very important. But thanks for tuning in. Share this with other people, and I'll see you on the next episode.